Welcome to all of you. My name is Dinesh Katre, and I come from India. I work with an organization called Center for Development of Advanced Computing. It is a scientific society under the Ministry of Information Technology. And this organization was set up to build supercomputers. So currently, we are also engaged in preparing the plans for the petascale and followed by the exascale computing. CDAC also diversified in various technological fields, such as language computing, and we also have people working on genome sequencing and really diverse areas. And it also now includes the area of digital preservation. Actually, I happen to have background in human-computer interaction. My PhD is in that field. But coincidentally, I got into the field of digital preservation. So I'll explain that as we go along. There is some background information which I wish to share with you about what happened, I mean, which events actually led us into the field of digital preservation. As the Ministry of IT was planning to conceive the National Digital Preservation Program for India, they felt that we should organize an Indo-US workshop to get some awareness and some exposure of the international best practices in digital preservation. And we applied for funding to Indo-US Science and Technology Forum, and they graciously supported us. And I'm very happy to acknowledge Dr. Martha Anderson, who is here. Around that time, we were corresponding with her. And she introduced us to many stalwarts and experts from the NDIP program as well as the Library of Congress, who joined in into this workshop, and this workshop was really a great success. As you can see, Dr. David Giretta was also very much involved, and almost on his own personal initiative, he really jumped into this, and he has been helping us relentlessly all these years. I mean, I wish to really convey my gratitude to him. So during this workshop, we had organized a panel to come out with recommendations for the National Digital Preservation Program, and based on those recommendations, we moved ahead. After that, this was the important step towards this, in which the Ministry of IT gave me a time-bound project, which was of 4 months duration, to come out with the a national study report on the digital preservation requirements of India. So in this activity, we involved 30 different organizations, and we invited position papers on the kind of data that they are managing, and what are the digital preservation challenges, and what is the kind of action plan they would like to propose in the short term as well as the long term. And as you can see, this involved representatives, basically the archivists and record keepers from diverse domains, like there is banking and insurance. We also have a lot of scientific organizations involved in this. You have Indian Space Research Organization, ISRO, is also there. Then we have National Institute of Oceanography, and then Defense Research Organization. So many of these scientific organizations also actually talked about the kind of scientific data that they are preserving. We also had the National Archives, and the most important player in this is the National E-Governance Action Plan, the NEGP, which is investing something like $10 billion USD into the e-governance across the country, and through which they are expecting whole lot of electronic records, the government records, to get generated, which will require to be preserved. So this was really a very diverse forum, and through that we came out with a common sort of program, and with the kind of budget, and you know, the what are the steps that the government should be really taking to realize this program. So all that was planned, and during that I also made a visit to UK, wherein David actually helped us in informing about what is happening, whether it is about the trustworthy digital repository audit and certification standard or various related activities, we got a lot of exposure, and that was very helpful in making this report. So having submitted the report, I thought my job is over. But then the ministry said that since you have done all this, then you should implement the first recommendation, which is to set up the Center of Excellence for Digital Preservation. So I was asked to submit a proposal in which we have signed the MOUs with National Archives of India for the government archives. We have signed MOUs with the Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts, which is the nodal institution for the cultural digital data, which they are accumulating really in large volumes. And we are also, most importantly, working with the NEGP, which is the National E-Governance Action Plan. So NEGP is basically the most important deliverable for us. It is the most important part of our work. During this making of the report, I actually had to study a whole lot of laws and acts within the Indian Constitution which justify or how they basically support the digital preservation. So it involved, you know, the Electronic Service Delivery Bill, which is knocking the doors of the parliament. It is yet to be passed, but once that bill will be passed, then all the government services, all the citizen services will have to be through electronic media, and within 5 years this target has to be achieved. We also have Information Technology Act, which actually categorically talks about preserving the electronic records in their original form, and one should be able to render them in the most authentic and reliable manner, you know, even after 10 or 20 or 50 years, depending on the life of that record. The Public Records Act also it gives certain mandatory recommendations for the all government agencies to preserve the records. Most notably, we have this Right to Information Act, which talks about the indexing and cataloging of the records, and one should be able to respond to the RTI query and produce the records within the time limit. So through this, the study of the laws, we tried to make a technical argument out of it. It's a techno-legal kind of presentation which appeals to the bureaucrats mostly. So since there is so much of legal support for this, we could get good support from the bureaucrats. The other interesting thing is the Central Secretariat Manual of E-Procedure, wherein the e-office implementation is happening through all government offices, wherein all the files and the documents which are processed in the manual fashion. I mean, it will happen in the electronic way, and the digital signature will play an important role in there. So this is that techno-legal perspective which I mentioned. In the scope of National Digital Preservation Program, we haven't really excluded any of the areas. You know, it is very encompassing. We have electronic records, cultural heritage data, audio, video, scientific data, websites, educational data, and even insurance and banking. We have tried to keep the scope as large as possible. And we have made our case through the technological imperatives, the legal imperatives, and highlighted on the absence of digital preservation strategies. In India, we currently do not have any tools, technologies, or the standards or guidelines in place. Even people are not trained to be able to handle this. So as the first step, the Center of Excellence for Digital Preservation Project has been granted to us, and it has started from April 2011 onwards. So it is just the 6 or 7 months have passed so far, and we are in the process of collecting the data from various organizations with whom we are working, and we are studying the nature of data, how it comes, whether the way it is produced, whether the preservation consideration have been put in place. These are the broad objectives of the Center of Excellence for Digital Preservation. First is conduct research and development and produce tools and technologies for digital preservation. The second is we are supposed to develop pilot digital repositories and help the government in building the national network of trustworthy digital repositories. This will be a long-term goal. The third objective is to come out with digital preservation standards by involving the stakeholders. And the fourth one is we will have to be providing inputs to the Department of Information Technology in terms of budgeting and funding various digital preservation initiatives in different areas. And the fourth one is to spread awareness and basically the digital preservation advocacy. So we will have a number of activities under there. So the same thing has been represented in a diagrammatic form. I'll not go into the details, but our primary focus would be on development of tools and technologies in the areas of how the submission information package gets created, how it will be archived, how it will be delivered, then the authenticity management, digital preservation audit. So the entire process, we are actually going into the details and finding out opportunities where tools could be developed, where systems could be put in place. And this will be on the basis of the study of the domain. So our tie-up with National Archives and the Indira Gandhi National Center of Arts. So we basically will be borrowing two different skills from these organizations. So National Archives will be basically contributing the archival science because these are mainly the archivists, whereas the IGNCA has a whole lot of library science expertise, so we will be banking on their knowledge pertaining to that. And both these things will contribute towards the preservation of bond digital records, because most of the government offices wherein the departmental record officers actually work, they don't have experience in archiving or the library science practices, you know, and bond digital record is a completely new field altogether. So this is how we can bring the interdisciplinary knowledge together in this area. The interesting case study, I would like to give you some awareness of what kind of digital records we will be dealing with. So through the NEGP program, the e-district mission mode project has been already launched, through which, you know, the various citizen services, particularly the certificates, will be offered through the digital process. So there are about 100,000 citizen service centers which have been set up already across the country. So through this, this citizen service center will have the computer network, and people will be able to submit their application if they want, for instance, a domicile certificate, so they can apply. Currently, 15 pilot e-districts are already implemented, and a lot of e-records are getting generated. And India has about 600 e-districts, 600 districts, so this can really scale up very large. And 31 state data centers are already being established. So these numbers will actually really grow, you know, as these projects spread out. The full plan has been executed. So the kind of certificates which are being issued by them are like domicile, caste certificate, birth certificate, death certificate, or you have driving licenses or arms licenses. The public distribution systems through which we have issue of ration card, you have passports and property tax, land records, so variety of certificates, and most of these have to be preserved for different durations. Like, for example, domicile would go for a lifetime of that person, or you have some certificates which are for the shorter duration. We also are working on the e-courts, wherein the court proceedings are now being recorded through the electronic media, and that requires to be preserved. So these are the 31 states, and the state data centers are already being built, and we consider this as the potential digital repositories, because as of today, the e-districts which are implemented, they don't have any facility or capability to preserve the e-records which they are generating. So at the moment, they are completely helpless in terms of digital preservation. So this is the sample screenshot of the database from which we have got from an e-district. As you can see, all the electronic records are basically the text entries in the fields of the database. So and it's a single database file. You know, the size is something like 2.5 terabyte. So if this one database is corrupted or if something goes wrong, almost a million records will simply be lost. You know, so we need to bring in a lot of. We have to suggest an alternate architecture or modify the existing architecture so that when the e-record is produced, it comes in a preservable form so that it could be preserved. Currently, it is not in that form. So this is the architecture of the e-district, which you can see where the data is collected from the citizen service center. Then it is processed, it is checked, verified, and then the certificate is issued. When the certificate is issued with a digital signature, it is stored in the database. So what they do is the key fields of information, they generate a hash out of it, and the signature is attached to the hash. So this is how it works. So in this model, this is the kind of change that we are suggesting to them. First is most of the e-district applications are not capturing the device ID or the technological provenance of the application data which is received from the citizen service center. So one doesn't know from where it came, from where it originated. It could be somebody can hack into the system and submit an application for domicile. I mean, we have many people who are illegally migrating into the country. So such people can apply for domicile, and that can be really dangerous. So provenance, the capturing the device ID of from where the application has been received is very important. And when it comes to the output, how the record is produced and the preservation description information has to be produced along with it, for which we are actually designing a new schema. I can just give a glimpse of it, like this is the Dublin core elements, and using which if you try to describe an e-record like driving license, one is not able to describe it, so because the parameters are completely different. So therefore, for e-certificates, we are actually working on a PDI which has got six different information blocks, out of which one of them I have just shared here. This is currently the draft. We are working on it will go through many changes. I'll come to the National Archives of India. They have a whole lot of heritage documents since the British times. They have the various government records which they have in their possession, which are in the physical form, or they have the microfilms. But they have been they have started digitizing all these materials. So they have something like 2.2 million. Records which will become digital very soon. And strategically, it was important for us to have National Archives as part of this activity. So therefore, we had them on board. Now, in case of National Archives, actually, this is leading to some change in the law, because as per the Public Records Act, every government office is supposed to preserve the records for 25 years, and only after 25 years they can transfer it to National Archives of India. Now, if it is born digital records, if nothing will be left to be transferred to National Archives, so they will be out of business. So we have to modify the Public Records Act, and some of the activities have got initiated through this work. We also have the state archives, and they are also somewhere linked with the National Archives. So we are trying to establish some linkages between these and evolve some standards and how the interoperability between the national and the state level archives can be made possible. Also, the ministries actually deposit the digital copies of the records. So how that could be made online, so we are working on some of those concepts. In case of Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts, they have the most interesting collection of rare manuscripts, which is in the digital form. The interesting thing is the manuscripts are on palm leaves, and they are all handwritten, and they are distributed across the country in villages. They are sometimes in the possession of individuals, and it's their family heritage. So there have been mobile digitization initiatives wherein people carried a computer and a scanner, and they visited the village and the house where they could digitize and just transfer those copies to Indira Gandhi National Center of Arts. So they have this huge collection of manuscripts, which, and the palm leaf manuscripts are really deteriorating. So preserving these digital copies is a very important issue. And so we are working with them. And they also deal with variety of other formats, such as WAV, MP3, and MPEG. So that brings us some opportunity to deal with different formats. Our aim would be to reach the level of trustworthy digital repository while we work with these organizations. I had to mostly confront with the people, because they always say, when you say trustworthy digital repository or digital repository, they'll say, are you setting up a data center? We already have it. So I felt there is a need to distinguish between a data center and a trustworthy digital repository. So this is the kind of diagram that I arrived at, and it has been helpful in conveying to people that, you know, having the organization's digital preservation policy in place, then having self-audit and the third-party audit and certification, archival administration, the organization structure, access to designated communities, risk management and mitigation standards, preservation tools, and open archival system. So all the layers have to be in place. Only then it could become a trustworthy repository. So this is what we are aiming at. So this is the website of National Digital Preservation Program. And as you can see, these are the current partners which we have with CDAC as the center of excellence. And we have National E-Governance Action Plan, National Informatics Center, National Archives of India, IGNCA, and then we have Delhi High Court, wherein the e-court has been implemented, and that is also involved with us. So you could visit this website at ndpp.in. Thank you.
So we do have time for some questions.
Yeah. If you have one or two questions, I will be happy to answer.
I just have a comment.
Yeah.
I think it's wonderful you're using Dublin Core for driver's license. I mean, take a tool and use it however you can. I find that interesting.
Yeah, but DCC is not suitable, actually.
Yeah.
I showed it to say that it doesn't suit the driving license. Okay, since there are no questions, I'll just thank you.
Well,
yeah.
You'll be around for the entire length of the conference, so I'm sure people will grab you in more informal times.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And now